service. We're growing. Our congregation is growing a little bit, and we're kind of reaching capacity, sometimes beyond capacity for our parking lot. So we're kind of maxed out sometimes, so when the majority of churches are declining in attendance and about 100 churches close their doors every week in America, these are really good problems for a church to have. And so much of the growth is because of you, by inviting people and sharing the podcasts and telling people about our kids program. That's how people are added to our family. So thank you, and thank the Lord for the blessing of church growth. It's great, but it does require some planning, some changes sometimes. As of now, we're just going to ask if you are very able-bodied, all right? Would you consider parking in the Columbiana Tire parking lot across the street? Okay, we have permission from them to park over there. And at the moment, we could use just a few extra spots some Sundays, okay? So we don't need half of you, like, parking over there. I need to say that because you're all kind and helpful, and I can just envision a scenario where everybody parks over there, and our parking lot is empty. That's not good either. So at this point, just a few spry folks, okay? If that changes, I'll let you know. Sound good? Good. So we're nearing the end of our series about our core values, and we are in the last value, which is living the gospel, correct? So here's the thing. I don't think we can talk about living the gospel without having a conversation about money. Okay, and you can't talk about money without having a conversation about generosity. And so that's the plan today, okay? So let's start off in Genesis 1. As you may know, God created the heavens and the earth, sun, moon, stars, mountains, oceans, trees, rivers, giraffes, porcupines, all of it. Then God created mankind in his own image. Then we'll pick up the story in verse 29. It says, then God said, look, I have given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food. And I have given every green plant as food for all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. Everything that has life. And that is what happened. So God made the world, but does God keep the world for himself? No. The scriptures say God gave. Adam, Eve, here's food, here's water, oceans, mountains, animals, here's beauty, here's creation. Rule over it. Partner with God in taking the world somewhere. Here's raw materials and food and water and drink and beauty. I've given it to you. Go ahead, make a world. Turn over to chapter 2. Look down at verse 8. It says, then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east. Then verse 15, the Lord God placed the man in the Garden of Eden to tend and watch over it. And that word tend in Hebrew means to draw out its potential. But the Lord God warned him, you may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die. Who planted the garden? God. The text says God planted a garden in the east. And God did not hold back the garden for himself. God gave the garden into Adam's hands. Here, work it, cultivate it, draw out its potential. Here's trees and food to eat and beauty for you to enjoy. Here's everything you need. Go for it. One of the first things you learn about God in the Bible is that God is generous. God's not frugal. He's not cheap, not a miser. God is lavish and extravagant with beauty and oceans and rivers and trees. God is generous. He's a giving God from the beginning. As the text says, God gave. He's a giving God. There are two ways of viewing the world. One is through the lens of entitlement, where you see the world as your world. And hey, I work hard for my money. It's my money, my paycheck. Get your grubby paws off my money, right? I earn a living. The other way is to look at the world through the lens of gratitude, where it's God's world, and it's all on loan. It's all grace. It's all a gift. Every dollar, every penny, every second, every breath, it's God's. You breathe God's oxygen, you eat God's food, drink God's water. Yes, you work, and you work hard to partner with God and take the world forward and all that, But it's all a gift. It's all grace. And you live in gratitude. In the beginning of the story, that is how Adam and Eve think about the world. But all that changes. Turn the page, Genesis 3. Genesis 3, it says, "The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, 'Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?' 'Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden,' the woman replied. 'It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die.' 'You won't die,' the serpent replied to the woman. 'God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you'll be like God, knowing both good and evil.' The woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious. She wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, who was with her. He ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves." Genesis 3 in theology is called the fall. And the fall turns cultivators into consumers. The fall moved Adam and Eve from gratitude to greed. The serpent in the story lies to Eve, and there's kind of all sorts of layers to the lie. But one facet is, hey, you just need this one thing. A bite from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and then you'll be happy. I mean, in a garden of yeses, any tree in the garden but one, Satan tempts Adam and Eve with the one thing they do not have, right? And here we are, who knows how many years later, and we buy into the exact same lie. If I just had this one more thing, then I'd be happy. When I get that house, when I get that car, when I get that trip, then fill in the blank. It's a sham, right? In fact, the opposite is true. The more you get, the more you want. I think of Rockefeller, a man who had more money than any human in the history of the world at that point, who was asked a century ago, how much money is enough? You know Rockefeller's answer? Just a little bit more. It's the problem with money, right? It's the problem with stuff. How much is enough? Just a little bit more. The fall created an insatiable desire in the human heart for more. It's like drinking seawater, right? Makes you more thirsty. It's never enough. And one generation after another falls for the lie. Now, fortunately, chapter 3 is not the end of the story. Turn over to chapter 12. So the end of chapter 3, Adam and Eve are put out of the garden. The text says to work the ground in sweat and toil. But God's not okay with leaving things like that. Genesis 12 opens with, "The Lord had said to Abram," later called Abraham, "Leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you." Now watch this. God makes a promise to Adam, to Abraham. "I will make you into a great nation. I will," what? "Bless you and make you famous. And you'll be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on earth will be blessed through you." Notice the language, through you. God wants to put it all back together. God wants to fix the brokenness of humanity. But God wants to do that through a people. First through Abraham and through Abraham's sons and daughters, later called Israel, all the way down to you and me. God says, "I'll bless you. I will put blessing into your lap, Abraham. And I want you to turn around and pass that blessing on." Abraham is blessed to be a blessing. And that rhythm, that calling from God, blessed to be a blessing, falls on the shoulders of all the sons and daughters of Abraham, all the followers of God down through history. That falls on you and me. In God's eyes, you are a conduit. Meaning when God puts blessing into your lap, it's not just to hook you up, right? It's not just because God is nice. It's not just because God loves you. All that's true, right? There's nothing wrong with enjoying his blessing, absolutely. But when God puts blessing into your lap, there's a reason. There's a purpose. Understand, God has an agenda. I hope you understand that. It's not random acts of niceness. No, God is up to something in the world. God wants to put it all back together. And you are part of that story. There's a plan. God wants you to step into the rhythm and take the blessings of God in your life and pass the blessings on. Now, that takes all sorts of different shapes and sizes, but the point is, there's a reason. There's a purpose for God's blessing in your life. And God wants you to step into the rhythm and pass that blessing on. Now, let's go to the New Testament. Turn to 2 Corinthians. I want to fast forward to first century Greece. The New Testament was written in huge chunks by a man named Paul. And I want you to see how Paul connects the dots between Abraham and Jesus and kind of fleshes out this blessed to be a blessing worldview. 2 Corinthians 8. Let's pick it up in verse 9. Right? Chapter 8, verse 9. Yep. Paul says, "You know the generous grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty he can make you rich." The ultimate example of blessed to be a blessing is not Abraham. The ultimate example is Jesus. Jesus was blessed, was in heaven with power and honor and glory, and he gave it all up to take on flesh and blood. Born to dirt poor working class parents up in Galilee in obscurity as a baby, no power, no glory, Paul says, and through Jesus' poverty, we are rich. We have the riches of his kingdom. Because Jesus models the blessed to be a blessing rhythm. Now that line is well known if you've been around church for a while. This line that so that by his poverty he can make you rich. That line is not abstract theology. Right? We're not reading a textbook, we're reading a letter. That line sits up against a backstory. And here's the short version of the story. 2 Corinthians is a letter written by Paul to the church in the first century city of Corinth. In the middle of the first century, there was a famine in the Middle East, and it hit Israel and the city of Jerusalem very hard. And the epicenter of the early church movement was in Jerusalem. And in Jerusalem, people were literally starving to death. Okay, so now meanwhile, Paul is hundreds of miles away, up in the Mediterranean, all over the Roman Empire, planting churches. In Greece and Macedonia, Italy, all over. Right? And Paul gets word of this famine back home. People are starving to death. The church in Jerusalem is suffering, specifically the Jewish church. And Paul sees an opportunity. Because one of the problems in the first century was there were Gentile churches, and oddly enough, the Gentile churches in one place did not get along really well with Jewish churches in another place. Very strange. I know. We no longer have problems with churches getting along at all, but this used to be a problem. But Paul sees this as an opportunity to bring the churches together. Because the Gentile churches, for the most part, were pretty well off. And the Jews back in Jerusalem had no money. And Paul says, okay, bright idea. And he starts going around to all the churches he had planted all over the empire and raising money for the poor in Jerusalem. And 2 Corinthians is a letter Paul sent ahead. So Paul's on his way to Corinth to take an offering. And he sent the letter ahead to get the Corinthians ready to give an offering to the poor in Jerusalem. All of chapter 8 and all of chapter 9 are about money and generosity. But we're going to read excerpts because we don't have time to get into all of it. But I want you to pay attention to how many allusions there are back to Genesis 12, blessed to be a blessing. Let's read chapter 8, verse 1. Paul writes, "Now I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters," or family, that's how Paul thinks about it, the church family, "what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia, a few hundred miles away up in the north. They are being tested by many troubles, and they are very poor, but they are also filled with abundant joy, which has overflowed in rich generosity. For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but far more. And they did it of their own free will. They begged us again and again for the privilege of sharing in the gift for the believers in Jerusalem." Can you imagine the Macedonians? "Paul, please. We want to give to the poor in Jerusalem. Please, please let us, Paul." And look at what Paul says next. 5. "They even did more than we had hoped, for their first action was to give themselves to the Lord and then to us, just as God wanted them to do." Notice the order. They gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us. To Paul, when you give your life to the Lord, it's easy to give your money. When you say, okay, God, here's my life, top to bottom, past, present, future, hopes, dreams, fears, the five-year plan, every dollar, my life is yours. I'm your disciple. It's your life. When you get there, when you get to that spot, God, I'm yours, it's easy to give your cash away. Because it doesn't belong to you anymore. It belongs to God. It's easy to give somebody else's money away, right? It's really fun, actually. Well, what if we were to think of money like that? What if it wasn't your money? What if it wasn't your time? What if it wasn't your day? What if it wasn't your decision? What if every little part of your life was God's? Would that change how we live? Absolutely. Paul says, okay, first you give your life to God. Then it's easy to be generous. 6. So we have urged Titus to encourage your giving in the first place, to return to you and encourage you to finish this ministry of giving. Since you excel in so many ways, in your faith, your speech, your knowledge, your enthusiasm, and your love from us, I want you to excel also in the gracious acts of giving. I mean, to Paul, giving is a natural part of your walk with Jesus, right? He lays out a list: faith, speech, knowledge, learning, right? Theology and scripture and reading the Bible, enthusiasm, passion for God, love, and giving. It's all lumped together. You cannot divorce your money or in your generosity or lack thereof from your walk with Jesus. It all goes together. Why is that? Jesus put it this way, Matthew 6:21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That's a fascinating thing to say, isn't it? Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Sounds backwards, doesn't it? Shouldn't it be wherever your heart is, that's where you will invest your treasure? It's not what Jesus says. He's saying you decide where you will start to put your treasure. You can begin to invest it in what has eternal significance now. And as you're making this choice of where to invest your treasure, you will train your heart in that direction. He's not saying let your heart decide where your treasure goes. He's saying decide where your treasure goes to move your heart there. Jesus is not after your money. God's not poor, right? Jesus is absolutely after your heart. And he knows, okay, how you spend money, you cannot divorce that from your heart or from your faith or your speech or your knowledge or your passion, your love. No, it all goes together. It's all about your walk with Jesus. Which is why Paul goes on and he says in 2 Corinthians, I'm not commanding you to do this, but I am testing how genuine your love is by comparing it with the eagerness of the other churches. What? Well, get the gravity of that. I want to test how much you love Jesus. How? Well, I want to pit you against the Macedonians and see who gives more money. That's kind of crazy, right? I mean, it's a full-blown competition to Paul. By the way, Macedonia and Corinth were ancient rivals. So think like Ohio State and Michigan. Ooh. I want to pit you two against each other. I want to test who's really the most serious about Jesus. I mean, it's crazy, but it's not a gimmick to Paul. He's dead serious. Because he knows that generosity is a measure of your love for what God is up to in the world. And then Paul says the line, you know the generous grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty he can make you rich. Meaning all generosity is in light of Jesus' generosity. You don't give from guilt or shame. You give in response and worship. You give in response to Jesus' generosity on the cross. Okay, skip down to chapter 9, verse 6. Paul lays out a few final thoughts on giving. He says, remember this. A farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. That's how the economics work in God's kingdom. You must each decide in your heart how much to give, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. Now look at this. And God is able to bless you, how much? To say? Abundantly. But don't stop reading there. I mean, I love the first half of this sentence. God's able to bless me abundantly. Okay, hook me up. Love Jesus, get a Ferrari, right? That's not Jesus' gospel. That's a prosperity gospel. It says God is able to bless you abundantly, comma, so what? So that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. It says God's able to bless you abundantly. In all things, at all times, having all you need. So you have enough to pay your bills, have enough for food, have shelter. You have enough to walk through God's beautiful world, smile on your face. Then you have extra for what? To abound in every good work. Your needs are met so that you'll be able to overflow with generosity. Now, there's a few reasons people are not generous, I think. One is ignorance. Maybe you're new to Jesus. You don't have a clue how all this works. For others, it's debt, right? You made some bad decisions. You don't live within your means. You know, you're a thousandaire who lives like a millionaire, and you're drowning right now. Just understand, debt makes your financial decisions for you. So I would encourage you, as soon as possible, get out of debt. Smaller house, older cars, eat some ramen, whatever you have to do. It is worth it for the peace of mind and for the ability to be generous. Those are a couple reasons I think people aren't generous, but I think for the majority, the reason is you don't actually believe that God's your provider. I don't say that to shame you. I'm speaking to myself here. But maybe you don't actually believe God is your provider. Like fathers, don't get me wrong. You have a responsibility in the eyes of God to work your tail off and take care of your wife and children. Absolutely. But you're not the provider. Sure, you work, but God is the provider. Maybe you're here and you think, dude, I'm out of work. Or I'm 12 years old. I work for my mom. Okay, listen, don't write off generosity just because you don't have much. Remember, generosity is about the heart, not about the amount of money. God's your provider. When you start to follow Jesus, you step into a story that goes all the way back to the garden, about a God who was generous, a giving God, a God who was at work in the world to put it all back together and fix the broken human heart through a people, through you. And you're blessed by God to be a blessing. And God calls you to step into that rhythm and take the blessing in your life and money and all sorts of ways, pass that blessing on in creative ways, generous ways. If you're a disciple of Jesus, you're called to take on that pattern and live lives as a conduit. Live with open hands. And you know, all the people I know who are marked by generosity are really happy. I don't think that's a coincidence, right? There's a freedom in giving. You know, one of the things that really changed my life was reading a book called The Treasure Principle by Randy Alcorn. Anybody read that? It's a good one, right? Short, easy read. There's a line in there. Randy says, giving is God's cure for greed. You know, I'm a pastor. I'm supposed to love poverty, I guess. Sorry, I don't. I love stuff. I'm not immune, right? I have that insatiable desire for more, and I hate it. Giving is God's cure for that. It's the opposite of what you would think, right? You think, oh, just buy one more thing. Okay, that's enough. But the opposite is true. Then you want 10 more. After that, 10 more. I drive an old beater, right? Works fine. The heat works. The AC works. Gets me around. I'm totally fine with it. Most of the time. The only time I feel like buying a newer car is when I ride in someone else's new car. Right? I'm more than happy with mine. I'm proud of my old beater. Then I ride in something new and I'm like, I would look good in something like this. I would be more happy if I had something like this. Giving is what sets you free from that. And if you're new around here, this sermon might be a lot. But understand our hearts. The pastors here are not out to get rich. If we were, I would put on a suit and tie and not say stuff that makes you mad ever, okay? You know, honestly, my big fear is today. Honestly, my big fear is that you're going to think I'm talking about money. But I'm only talking about money in so much as it reveals what's really going on in your heart. I'm not taking another offering, not making a plea, not trying to buy anything new, not trying to get a raise. I'm not asking you for money. So if you're a skeptic in here today and you're like, I knew this is what churches are all about, go buy yourself something. I don't want it. This isn't about money. It's only about money in that money is maybe the greatest revealer of what you truly value, regardless of what comes out of your lips. So the question today is not, should you tithe or should you not tithe? We're not talking that stuff. I'm asking what you really value. I'm asking what's really going on in that heart of yours. Because where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. And where your heart is, that's where your affections are. And where your affections are, you'll view the world through those lenses, through that lens. Worldly or kingdom, consumer or contributor. And I want to make this perfectly clear. If you have a lot of money and you have a lot of nice stuff, that doesn't mean you're doing something wrong or that you're a sinner. The sermon's not about the amount of money that you have or make. The point is, where's your heart? Where are you investing your treasure? And how do you see the world? Is it a world of scarcity, where you're here for a season, there's only so much to go around, so you should take and hoard and it's mine? Or rather, do you see all that you have in the world around you as being entrusted with what belongs to a generous God for the business and purpose of the kingdom of God? Those are two ways of seeing. It's been incredible how God's been, I think, stretching us and growing us. I really think God's doing something special here. And I know, all I know is I want to live by more faith, not less. Am I alone in that? I want to live with more generosity, not less. I want to tap into what God is doing in the world as an open-handed conduit for God's extravagant generosity. Blessed to be a blessing. Amen? All right, let's pray. Father, I just thank you that we can come together and open a scripture. My hope and my prayer is that you would just speak to us, that we would look deeply into our hearts, Lord. Just look and see what does create joy and happiness in my heart. Is it the stuff and the trinkets and the things that give me energy, or is it you and the pursuit of you and the ability to give generously? I pray that you would teach us the joys of seeing the world like this, Father. And Lord, I just pray that you would imprint on our hearts that we are a conduit for your abundance. Conduit for your abundant generosity, that we are blessed to bless. We love you and you thank you for this beautiful, beautiful day. And everybody said, Amen.